December 3rd turned out to be a date which almost a million people would remember, and that was because of one of the deadliest accidents that ever happened, which was the Bhopal gas tragedy. There were almost 4,000 plus official deaths. It said it's gone up till 15,000 or more people have died, and almost 500,000 people have suffered and are still suffering its effects. This is when the engineers realized the need for safety, and two of the most important functions that are used are functional safety and inherent safety. In this video, we'll actually implement functional safety and inherent safety in Bhopal gas tragedy and learn in one of the most simplest way of how we can implement and what is the concept behind it. So without further delay, let's get into it. The first thing is, for this, I would take an example of a gun and bullets to understand functional safety and inherent safety. And the basic concept to remember is, inherent safety controls the hazard is a wrong definition. It basically tries to avoid the hazard, and it is the functional safety which tries to control the hazard. So we must not correlate with saying that functional and inherent safety are one and the same. No, they're not same. Let's take this example to understand it. So for example, in my system of gun and bullets, I want to implement inherent safety. So what I would do is, inherent safety, as we said, tries to avoid the hazard altogether. So inside the gun and bullets, what is the hazard? It is the bullets. So it would try to avoid the bullets. How? So whenever the gun has to be kept somewhere, it should be kept without bullets. So the gun becomes inherently safe when not in use. Now, what do you think would be the example for functional safety? For functional safety, we will use something like child lock. Basically, it's a function that is implement which controls the hazard. But the hazard is present in the system. So here, we might put a child lock so that when the child lock is active, the bullets would not be able to be fired by a gun or somebody by mistake. So this is the aspect of functional safety. However, there is this concept which always comes in, what if the child lock fails? For this case, engineers are having a two-step process. The first one is to identify the hazard. So, an engineers do a study of the plant or the process, which studies like hazard, etc. Where they identify the what is the hazard and what could be the consequences of that hazard. Once that is identified, then the step number two is to define the safety function. So you have something like SIL 1, SIL 2, which is called a safety integrity level, and SIL 3. So SIL 3 is one of the highest amount of safety function that is implemented, and SIL 1 being the lowest. Now this depends on the hazard and which safety level should be implemented. For defense systems, usually we go up till SIL 3. If it's a regular plant, we might just go for SIL 1. Depends on the hazard. Now we look into actual Bhopal tragedy and how we could have implemented inherent safety and functional safety. So always remember, as an engineer, first you need to try to make the system inherently safe. After that, we can't always make a system inherently safe. So after that, you would go for something like functional safety. So let's look into the Bhopal gas tragedy and how we could have avoided with using functional safety and inherent safety. So the material that got leaked was MIC, which is one of the most toxic chemical substances. And this incident has also been again happened in the Bio Corporation accident. And that is when we realized that we need to take lessons from our previous incidences that happened. So now here, if I'm applying MIC on an inherent safety discussion, the first thing we could do is, we could first try, can we substitute the hazard? So what if I use a non-toxic substance in my process? Is that possible? This is the first way, which is called a substitute. So try to substitute the hazard, which is something which is non-toxic. So that just makes the things inherently safe. If that is not possible, then we go for the next thing, which is to minimize. For example, for the Bhopal thing, a lot of people came up with this concept that so much huge tanks of MIC storage were not required genuinely by the plant. So if the amount of storage is less, the leakage would happen would be less, and thus the system would be more inherently safe. So we try to minimize the hazard which is there. The third way is that what if we can add something to dilute it? So for example, when we have to store, we dilute it with something else, and once when we re-need it back, we can try to separate the two. A lot of times this might seem to be expensive, but if we see the amount of fines and the issues that need to be given to someone when an accident happens, that is the government or the people compensation, this seems to be a very minimum cost. This is called as to moderate the hazard. Now, the final step also could be that we have to simplify the systems. So for example, if it's the MIC line, we'll try to reduce the amount of flange joints which can lead to leakage, etc. So this is called as to simplify the system. Now, we look into the next one, which is functional safety. Now, functional safety in that MIC might be present, but we'll try to find out, can I have some interlocks, like as soon as the gas leaks, I'll try to close off the valve, or as soon as there is the tanks are depressurizing, that means there is some leak and I can close off the valves, or I can close off the main MIC line, or maybe have a suction line that sucks all the MIC instead of releasing it outside, or I can have gas detectors. As soon as a leak is detected, the entire functional safety system tries to suck the MIC out from the atmosphere. So we could use such methods, which is part of functional safety. Now, in conclusion, we can say that inherent safety basically deals with avoiding the hazard as much as possible, and functional safety tries to control the hazard so that it does not allow its consequences to happen. So we try to use some functions. So inherent safety is passive in nature and functional safety is more active in nature. Also, I would like to share that every Saturday I produce a new video. So if you're liking this video, please subscribe and especially press the bell icon so every Saturday you can learn something new. Also, I have written a free ebook on engineering standards. It's completely free. There have been 2,500 plus downloads from engineers like Shell, Dow, DuPont, Woolley, Technip, etc. The link is given in the description below. I think you might like this ebook. And if there is any doubts, please feel free to contact me. Until next Saturday, happy learning.